Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
We think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we watch a movie.
Watch a movie, yeah.
Driving chewing buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas,
we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. We love to watch you cause you're our favorite show.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas,
hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Now, the best part of the show, the running heads watch.
You make me feel like we're spinning top. You make me feel like we're spinning top. Spinning top, spinning top. Baby, you make me feel like we're spinning top.
Yeah, you made me spin. Now, show me that banana again. I've got to see it because it's too quick for me. Groovy. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Yeah, that's a big effort. I love it. Hey, how much was that at the grocery shop?
I went to the self-service. I got three bananas. I scanned it, and I swear it came out to 1 cent. And I'm like, how can this be 1 cent? Because I had no cash. I was going to use a card. I don't use cash anymore. So I called the woman over from the big supermarket. I said, how can three bananas cost 1 cent? Am I going to charge 1 penny? And she rescanned it, and it came out to 88 cents for three bananas. And this one is groovy with plastic EP.
So one banana for me, one banana for you, one banana for Vicky. That's really great. Now, listen, we've got a very big show happening. But before we do, tell everybody about your fantastic radio show that's coming out Saturday and Sunday. They're in Boston. Tell everyone.
Thank you very much. I do want to tell you, welcome to the Plastic EP and Chachi live show. We do shows all the time, sometimes prompt. Not scheduled. We just say, let's go on the air. So always be subscribed to Plastic EP on Facebook and Breakfast with the Beatles Chachi on Facebook. I have a show called New England's Breakfast with the Beatles, Saturday mornings, Eastern Standard Time on 91.9 FM WUMB in Boston, Sundays in New Hampshire and Maine on Seacoast Oldies 92.1 and 97.1. And at those respective radio stations, you can hear the show all over the world. I am originating out of Boston, just outside of near Cape Cod, while the great Plastic EP is broadcasting live right now from Melbourne, Australia. He's broadcasting from tomorrow. It's Saturday right now.
Now, I believe you're a big fan of Rifleman, and I believe you're a big fan of the Munsters. Yes. And I know you've got your TV going all the time watching those shows, and it's really good. Now, is Rifleman on DVD?
No, it's on broadcast television, 1 hour.
And the Munsters is on broadcast television too, yeah?
Yes, on Cozy TV. Rifleman was just on, and I just said it was Saturday, but it's really, what, Thursday? My days are so mixed up. But yeah,
Rifleman. We're too busy trying to please the world. That's why we're going to keep going. Now, we've got a very, very big show. And coming in from the UK now, we're going to introduce him, Mr. David Stark. Come in, Mr. David Stark. How are you today?
Oh, here I am. Yeah, I'm fine, thanks, guys. Nice to see you. Yeah, great to be with you.
Us too. Yeah. Now, let me tell you, David, before we start and we get into what this is all about, today is, let's say, this week is the 52nd anniversary of the Beatles rooftop concert in 1969, and that's what we're going to celebrate today. We've got another special guest coming on, but let me tell you this. Before we start that, David, we know you were here and we want to introduce you to a segment called Show Me Your Beatles Stuff. Now, you're very fortunate because we don't usually get another person on, but you are here. So welcome to the segment. Show me your Beatles stuff and Chachi now will show us something. Show us something.
Chachi. I pulled a few items out of my collection. And since it is the anniversary on Saturday, January 30th, when the Beatles played on the rooftop at Apple, I have two copies of this great book that came with the UK Let It Be album. Now, Mr. Stark, you were in the UK. You probably saw this. Maybe you bought the box set, the Let It Be album.
I bought it the day it came out. The very first day of release, sure.
And did you get this book in the album?
Yeah. Yep.
So
I've got my original.
I have two of them. Yeah. And at one point, I grew up in Cambridge, Massachusetts, near Harvard Square. You probably heard of Harvard University.
Yeah.
There was a record store there selling just the books for 99 cents each.
Jeez. That's amazing.
Hey, Chachi, I've got to say something. That's one thing I don't have. I don't have one of the books.
Oh,
so
keep
a copy there because you never know what we might trade.
Okay? And I have two of them here, and but they're mine. Yeah,
don't worry. I got a very special book, Where's Ringo? Upstairs. It's very hard to get, so we'll see.
Okay, and I also have a couple other things. We have the She Loves You sheet music.
That's now,
I also have, I saw her standing there, autographed by Paul. He autographed it for me.
Right.
And then I have this box. Check this out, this little box here. And inside, oh, Jesus. Inside of the Abbey Road figures.
Oh, great.
Very, very heavy. I don't know what they call them, but there they are crossing Abbey Road in this little box. And then my final item for the show today, I bought this when back in the day when it came out. It's still in the shrink wrap. It's the American Introducing the Beatles album.
Great. And
there's the sticker still on it for a very low price of $1.98. The original VJ Introducing the Beatles album.
Oh, that's cool.
And
now,
those
before you disappear there, let me show you something while you're there. Tell me you have not seen this, David, all right? 1969, original music sheet, Australian Come Together.
There's
the back cover. I bet you haven't seen that because it's only Australian. Am I right?
That's right. No, I haven't seen the Australian copy, sure.
Penny Lane, Australian again. You haven't seen that. But this is the one that's the piece of resistance. No one has seen it. No one's got it. I'm very lucky to have this one. Australian rock and roll music. How groovy is that?
Oh, that's great. So you got a lot of sheet music, Plastic. Have you got much?
I've got a lot of things, David. My house is full of collectibles and my wife gets them and puts them out in the street to declutter what I'm doing down here. So very hard when you try to hang on to your stuff. I've got a recording studio upstairs that's full of so much stuff that my wife tends to take it out in the street for people that are looking for things. But also, The Rubber Soul, Australian songbook album.
Excellent.
Came out. Look at these. I believe these are Italian. These are Italian photos. They're also in a book. There's Ringo coming out of a plane. Look at that shot.
Excellent.
There's Ringo playing flamingo guitar.
Oh, that's very
Every
good.
Every photo is Ringo. That's Ringo doing his tie. Anyway, back to business.
I love the picture of Chachi and Ringo. I think that's a great photo.
Thank you very much, David. Yeah, thank you.
It's a really good one.
Thank you,
sir. He's the only one I still haven't got my picture with. All these years, I've met him plenty, and it just never worked out getting a photo with him, even though I've taken photos of him. But I'm just going to have to wait another short while to get one.
But also, David, let me tell you, you and Chachi are very fortunate people because you got photos with Paul McCartney, and I've never met him or taken a photo. So congratulations on that, you guys. Now, I've got something very special to show everybody there. And as I said, we're going to wait. There'll be text coming in. There'll be everything coming in. But let me show you something. This is David's book, right? Go and buy it. It's a bestseller. It's got one of the best covers in the world. It's All Too Much by David Stark. Get on the internet. Go and buy it. Where can they buy it? David, give out the links.
Well, I guess for the international audience, it's on Amazon and other platforms. You'll find it on Amazon now. If you want a signed copy, then you'll have to go through my site and it's no extra to order a signed copy. It's just the postage. So it's just it's alltoomuch.net, and you'll get the links there to the publisher's site where you can order it. And I'll sign it and I'll ship it off. That's what I've been doing since it came out before Christmas. I'm spending every morning sending out signed copies, which is great.
Well, it's going to be a big sell. Now, before we do that, here's our special guest, Tony Barrett. Hi. Welcome to the show. Plastic EP, Chachi, and of course,
hi,
David Stark. How are you, Tony?
Yeah, good to see you all.
Hello, Tony. Great. Welcome.
Hi.
Now, Tony. I just want to say to everyone out there in the world, now, Tony's got a fantastic book. I've seen it everywhere in Australia, Tony, because I go to bookshops.
That's good to hear, Plastic.
Here it is, yeah. The Beatles on the Roof. I haven't bought a copy yet, but you never know. One might come to my house autographed. Right?
Yeah, I hope so.
The Beatles on the Roof. That's what a great book. And what a great cover.
Oh, that's a nice look.
David has his copy.
I'll have to pay that back. Look, there you go.
Ah, look at this.
Now, gentlemen. That's now, gentlemen, funny. Before we start, I just want to bring your attention to something. We're celebrating the 52nd anniversary of the Beatles rooftop concert. And what we've done now is we've got a very special little video, and it's an audio and video that David has made about his book. It's about chapter 6. Have a look at this great little video. Here we go.
Meanwhile, the Beatles weren't letting the Stones get it all their own way in the TV specials department. As was quite usual in their friendly rivalry, they often seemed to do things in parallel or take the mickey out of each other. Think of the sleeves of Sgt. Pepper and their Satanic Majesty's Request, or album titles Let It Be and Let It Bleed, for example. So, just as the Stones were about to film the Rock and Roll Circus in front of an invited audience, the December 1968 edition of the Beatles Book Monthly featured a quite extraordinary flash announcement on its front cover. 100 Beatles show tickets to be won. Inside the magazine was a coupon entitling 50 lucky readers to receive a pair of tickets to what was casually described as the world's biggest concert, based on official information provided by Apple. It seemed that the Beatles were planning to return to live performing by filming their own TV spectacular, reportedly set to take place at London's Roundhouse, actually booked for 3 nights, an outdoor amphitheatre in Tunisia, or an equally obscure location somewhere around the world. This was astounding news, so for the second time in a month, I immediately responded for the chance of winning tickets to an exclusive show which would surely go down as one of the most historic events in pop music history, a hopefully triumphant return by the Beatles to the concert stage just 2.5 years after exiting San Francisco's Candlestick Park in 1966, would surely even eclipse Elvis Presley's much-touted comeback special, 68, which by coincidence were televised on December the 3rd. It all seemed too good to be true, and I should have realised that was exactly what it was, if only I'd paid more attention to the small print nestling under the ticket offer, which stated, at press time, it is not possible to tell you the exact dates of the performances, which will be videotaped in colour in the new year. Neither the Beatles themselves or their Apple helpers have sorted that out. But what did I care? I'd sent off my letter with the coupon straight away and eagerly awaited the February edition of the Beatles book, in which the names of all the 50 lucky winners were to be published. Sure enough, my name was included, but, sadly by then, the anticipation and excitement of the planned show had been totally dissipated by the now common knowledge that the entire plan had been abandoned. Things had changed dramatically during the group's extensive sessions at Twickenham Film Studios and at their Apple Studios, resulting in what eventually became the Let It Be album and film, which weren't released until May 1970. While Paul, the eternal showman, was naturally keen on the concert idea, the others weren't as sold on it, George even quitting the band for a few days in early January 69, just as Ringo had the previous August. However, as the eventual film portrays in all its stark rawness, the group finally all agreed to play some of their new material at a one-off lunchtime concert held on the roof of the Apple Building at 3 Savile Row on Thursday, January the 30th. They were also joined by organist and old friend Billy Preston, an important catalyst in their sudden decision to perform, as he'd been filming with them for the documentary. "Well, thanks very much, chaps, for telling me. Not. I was at school that day and only heard about the rooftop show on the news when I got home. What a complete and utter swizz. I'd won tickets for the greatest gig of all time, and what do they do instead? Play a cracking set on their office roof for a few industry pals and girlfriends, along with passers-by below and some office workers who are enterprising enough to clamber up to the nearby roofs or the actual rooftop. Sadly, there wasn't much I could do about it, other than wait for a promised consolation prize, which the Beatles Book Monthly announced would be sent in due course."
Now, I just want to thank you, David, for the worldwide exclusive, because that's been shown here on this show first out to the world. So thank you, David. That was a very great effort there. Now, Chuck, you'll ask a few questions about the rooftop.
Yes, David, what was the consolation prize?
The consolation prize didn't come till quite a few months later, and it was just a copy of Abbey Road about a week to 10 days before it came out, so which was nice enough, but it wasn't signed, it wasn't an advanced copy, it was just a regular copy, which I still have. So to be honest, at the end of the video, you see the letter which I got from Beatles & Co., signed by Peter Brown and Ringo, and that is worth a lot more to me than the album itself, the standard album. So, you know, that's just a fantastic souvenir of, you know, what could and should have been, and why they didn't ring me up to say, "Come on, leave school, come down."
Wow. Who knows?
Well, I was disappointed as well, David. Although I don't have as much claim to have been there as you have, because you were a prize winner and you won the competition. But I didn't. I just went to school on the Friday, and I was stopped by some sort of some know-it-all who said to me, "Tony, you're into the Beatles, aren't you? He wouldn't have said that then. He said, "Tony, you like the Beatles, don't you?" I said, "Yeah, rather." And he said, "Did you hear that they played a special concert at their place in London yesterday?" And I said, "No." And I sort of almost burst into tears. I was sort of angry and sad at the same time. My young brain was thinking, I was tiny then, my young brain was thinking, they must know I'm a huge fan. You know, I've sent them fan mail over the years. You know, why didn't they invite me? So I was disconsolate.
I know the feeling.
So Tony, give us a little background on you, because we know about David. He has a fantastic, so many experiences as a kid. Tell us about yourself. Where were you located as in relation to the Apple Records building? Did you ever see the Beatles live in person? Are you a first generation?
No, my elder sister did go and see the Beatles once or twice, I think. I think it was in London, and then PJ Proby was supporting, and she couldn't hear a thing, because, you know, you couldn't hear the music. So it was that. This is the interesting thing about incidentally about the rooftop concert. It was like the opposite of Beatlemania, wasn't it? Because most people in the street could hear the band, but they couldn't see them. Whereas Beatlemania was all about, you know, seeing the band and not being able to hear them. So that's interesting, isn't it? Yeah. But at the time of the rooftop concert, I was a little boy going to school in Crawley in Sussex, which is about 30 miles from London. But if I'd known, I would have hopped on a train, because I did naughty things like that. I sort of I jumped on trains and got myself into scrapes, you know.
I just want to say something. Being here in Australia, you've got to understand, we got the news like 6 months later. On the TV, everything's black and white, right? That's how it was then. We didn't have colour. So we're finding this information and seeing this little promo clip of the police walking around, people walking the street, looking up. No one knows what's going on. I mean, I'll be quite frank. Must have been so weird for the people in the London streets not knowing what's going on while they're working or going shopping, to hear this big noise, because it must have been a massive noise out in the streets. But, I mean, How would it be you're looking at a roof and you don't know what's going on the roof? That's that to me, being on the ground level, it's pretty weird.
The lucky people were the people in the offices on like the fourth or fifth floor all around, you know, who had a ringside seat of the whole gig. And some of them crawled out the windows and walked along other roofs to see them, get a closer look. You know, I interviewed quite a few people who saw them from windows, or one guy actually climbed out of a window and walked across a couple of roofs. I mean, quite dangerous stuff, climbing up drain pipes and things.
There was actually no barrier for the Beatles as well. There was just a pole going across. Yeah. And you got cameramen lying on the ground near the edge. Yeah, so what it was, you know, safety
the words,
plus out there.
The words health and safety weren't put together then, you see. Totally. They were separate words.
I've got to tell you something, Plastic, that I could have had another coup for you tonight, because I emailed a friend of mine in the business. Well, I emailed a lot of people to look in tonight, and I had an email back from this friend of mine, John, who said, oh, I wish I'd known earlier, because I managed Ken Wolfe, who was the policeman who was sent up to try and stop them playing as a young copper. Well, Tony's met him. I know him as well. I was on the roof of him on the 40th anniversary. Real nice guy. I had no idea that my friend has got any involvement with him. He said he's been managing him for 20 years. So I said, great. If he's free tonight, he can come on the show as well and join us. Unfortunately, he said he's a bit out of the loop at the moment. So another time.
Ken's a lovely guy. Ken has good claims to fame. He was one of the policemen who came to stop the show and didn't really want to stop it because he was a fan of the Beatles and really carry on. Also, he was Princess Diana's bodyguard.
Later.
Okay, I didn't know that. But also, may I say, I've asked Leslie Cavendish if he's able to come on the show. It's a bit short notice. Now, Leslie has written a book called The Cutting Edge.
Famous
now, Leslie Davis. Actually went to the concert but couldn't make it to the roof. So he was one level at Paul and John and Ringo's and George's feet.
Yeah, he wouldn't let up. They wouldn't let him
going
up.
On. So, I mean, how great is that?
It's brilliant. I suspected for a while that Jimi Hendrix was there at the rooftop concert because he lived just around the corner in Brook Street, and Mayfair is quite a small place. But I thought, why wasn't Jimmy there? Because, you know, the Beatles went to see Jimmy off quite often when he played, like at the Savile Theatre and places like that. And Jimmy would often, repay the favour. But I found out that he was on a plane to America to win to accept an award from Rolling Stone magazine. So that's why he wasn't there.
Wow.
Interesting.
Well, funny enough, here's another anniversary. It's January the 29th, 1967. I was watching The Who, supported by Jimi Hendrix Experience at the Savile Theatre with all the Beatles there that night. I was at that. That was the first big rock show I ever went to.
Amazing.
That's the anniversary tomorrow, followed by the rooftop anniversary on Saturday. Big weekend.
And the rooftop concert happened on January the 30th, of course. That was also Phil Collins' 18th birthday. I don't know where he was at the time. He wasn't there. He'd been, as David has pointed out, and as David knows, I'm sure, Phil Collins was an extra in A Hard Day's Night, wasn't he?
He was
at the La Scala, I think, wasn't he? The Scala?
That's right.
I watched it again last week, on TV.
Yeah. I also got to say, if I may, you got to understand, living in Australia during the 60s, it's not like today where you get something instant. We're behind the eight ball. But you got to understand something. Australia was in the 60s, very British, the Queen. We always knew what was happening in the UK. But for you guys growing up and living in the UK, I'm just saying, the Beatles, James Bond, these are things that are in your culture that are like so great. So I mean, the end of the Beatles, I can remember being in high school and someone having a newspaper and just walking down a corridor and crying. A fellow student, I said, what's wrong? He goes, the Beatles broke up. It's not like you guys where you know about the constant instantly, oh, the Beatles played live. You know what I mean? So this is why now we live in a different time. But back then, it must have been so amazing and heartbreaking that the Beatles broke up. Tell me what it was like when you learnt the Beatles broke up, David and Tony.
Yeah, well, I was pretty upset. It wasn't a big surprise, I have to say. We kind of knew it was coming, so it wasn't such a big surprise, except the way that it was done with Paul, you know, kind
he interviewed
of
using himself, didn't he?
The split to promote his solo album, really. So it was a bit sneaky, but he certainly got the benefit of it.
I think even as a young boy, I was aware that the Beatles were finished, really, because John and Yoko were popping up everywhere. I mean, John was clearly having a second career, and it was taking up most of his time. And I thought, well, he can't have much time for the Beatles anymore. And John said himself, you know, I left the Beatles long before Paul announced that he'd left. That's you know, so
they also, you know, what gets to me about the Beatles that a lot of people don't talk about because they can't recognize this. All right, now when the Beatles started and they became the biggest phenomenon in the world, what I don't like is they got so many negatives. Like every day, when are the Beatles breaking up? When are the Beatles breaking up? I mean, you talk about pressure. They've just made it, and everybody wants to know when they're breaking up and they're going in their career. To me, you can only put up with that so much. Yeah. You can appreciate that too. When you're worldwide success, and everybody is like the big news is, oh, the Beatles are going to break up. But oh, David Clark's going to be bigger. Oh,
the Beatles were brilliant. I mean, like, I think the Beatles were brilliant at confounding people's expectations. You know, people might have expected another Rubber Soul or something when Revolver came out, and Revolver was a big step forward. And then obviously Sgt. Pepper after that, another huge step forward. The Beatles were sort of kind of thumbing their noses at the public sometimes, saying, "Look, you don't know what's coming next from us, but it's going to be amazing." Mm. You know.
Well, it's certainly interesting that they would come back after the Let It Be fiasco and put out Abbey Road.
Yeah.
It's amazing, isn't it?
What a beautiful album. How
they managed to pull it all together. And you have to credit George Martin a lot for getting it. They wanted to do it, and he made sure it was going to be, in my opinion, their best album. Right?
See,
this is relevant too, because I'm saying the new generation of Beatles fans don't understand that Abbey Road was the last album recorded, but it wasn't the last album released. See,
that's right.
We talk like this, but the average person out there's got no idea. So the Beatles do Let It Be, then they get it together. They do Abbey Road, then Abbey Road is released, even though that's the newer record, and then Let It Be comes after. So I mean, you got to put it in perspective, because so many people out there, believe me, they're surprised when you tell them these things.
Let It Be the album, the record company, you know, to make money.
Which was going to be called Everest.
Yeah, Everest.
They were
actually thinking of doing a photo shoot somewhere up Everest, probably on base camp, not at the summit, I don't think. And you know how amazing that would have been. You know, you would do it on Photoshop now, wouldn't you? You know.
Yeah, but that's also a brand. That's also a brand of cigarettes too.
Yeah,
they should have gone to Peace and Lake.
Sorry.
Let's go again. We've got two people talking at once.
Sorry,
but the thing about the Beatles was, you know, they had these grand plans for the Let It Be finale, grand plans for Abbey Road.
It's a similar thing, isn't it?
It's like, let's just go out and cross the street. Let's just go up on the roof.
Yeah, Charlie, I've been aware of that similarity for quite a while. The fact that, you know, let's just go and play on our roof. Oh, let's just go and walk across the road are two very similar decisions, aren't they?
They are.
Isn't that convenient? Let's just get it over.
Hey, let's take our shoes off. Let's go walk the street.
Let's do it
on top of our building. I mean, talk about convenience.
Yeah. But the amazing thing on both occasions, on the Zebra Crossing and with the rooftop concert, they created classics. Just by almost not caring. You know, that's how brilliant they were. They didn't really have to try sometimes.
True. Right,
but they did have the Roundhouse booked. There's actually a small advert for the Beatles at the Roundhouse, which was published in Time Out.
Really?
Believe it or not, there's actually I've got a copy.
Wow, didn't know about that.
They'd actually booked the Roundhouse, which obviously never happened. But just coming back to Let It Be, of course, they abandoned the whole album to then work on Abbey Road. And we all knew at the time that Let It Be was still, you know, on the shelves and nothing was happening until later 1970, when Phil Spector was brought in, of course, finished it. And then everyone's wondering, what's it going to be like? And we know what the result was. And of course, you know, he died last week, so we couldn't get him on the show, unfortunately. But I still like his version of the album, believe it or not.
Yeah, I mean, Paul vehemently disliked the strings on Long and Winding Road. I think they're okay, actually. I think they just put the ribbon on the chocolate box, really, for me. You know,
hey, I've got to say something, okay? You know what I like? John Lennon is in New York, whatever. They're bugging him every day when the Beatles get together. So now he's copping that, right? And then, guys, listen, you want to listen to a Beatles album? We got more freedom now. We're more creative. Get one of my songs. Get one of Paul's. Get one of Ringo's. Get one of George's. And your own compilation. And there you go. Yeah. There's the Beatles. Yeah, yeah. I mean, how smart is that?
Yeah. Yeah. That's great. True.
Let me ask
these mixtapes.
Let me ask the two authors this question, Tony and David. I mean, the Beatles couldn't really decide on anything as a group. All four could really had problems agreeing. Is it? And I've read stories that even minutes before the show was going to happen on the roof, they're standing in the hall saying, "You know, should we do this or not?"
They nearly bottled it. And my take on it is that, although Paul was being very bossy around that time, and you can see that in the Let It Be film, he had very fixed ideas about what should happen, and it was the one with the work ethic at the time. It's as if John Lennon suddenly assumed leadership again and said, "Okay, we're going to do this," because he said he'd sort of he swore a bit and said, "Let's do it," and I think that was John asserting his control for possibly the last time, in the Beatles.
Also, may I say,
good point.
They had organized what they had to do on the rooftop. It wasn't a 1 minute job, right? But what I'm saying is, I believe that John Lennon wanted the end of it to be like the police come grab him, put him in a van, and try and arrest him.
That. You're right.
I reckon that would have been a really great scenario in his mind, going, yeah, that would be really great. Yeah. Let him arrest us. Is that correct to assume that?
I think you're right there. I think he did want it. I think he's quoted as saying that, and I think they were a bit upset when it didn't happen.
Yeah, it would be the only time they got arrested for nothing to do with drugs.
Yeah.
I think that Alan Parsons is quoted as saying that the danger element, the fact that they could have been, arrested, made them more excited and made them more enthusiastic about the music. And you can hear that in the music, I think. I love the rawness of the that stuff, Dig a Pony and I've Got a Feeling and Don't Let Me Down. I love the sound of that music.
Well, I got to say, in the clips, the best part of the clips are the police vans coming to surround the Apple building.
Yeah. I don't know what we're
saying yet. Walking up and down. And sergeants looking at each other like, what are we going to do? We can't even get up there. And they're knocking on the door like for half an hour, 45 minutes.
Those black bands.
And still playing. What a class.
Plastic, I don't know what you call them in Australia. They're called Black Mariahs here. Those
big black bands.
And the misunderstanding about the Black Mariah that came into Savile Row. People thought, they're going to arrest the Beatles. They're going to grab the Beatles and put them in the back of this van. But actually, that Black Mariah, the policemen themselves told me, the two policemen I interviewed, said, no, that Black Mariah was there to deliver more policemen to the scene because they were worried about the crowds. They were worried about the traffic. They wanted to clear the road. So the Black Mariah was coming in to deliver more police, not to take the Beatles off.
One thing I wanted to ask both of you, because everyone, a lot of people think it was a real concert. They were actually filming the finale. They were rehearsing songs. They did multiple versions.
That's right.
It wasn't like a half hour show with seven songs.
Absolutely. When was the last time you went to a concert and they had, the band had a few goes at something?
Yes.
It's just not right. You'd have to ask for your money back, wouldn't you?
Okay, I just want to say this. Paul Endicott said, The police station was 100 yards away. So, I mean, they really didn't need the vans, did they? You could walk.
No.
They didn't need vans. But the thing is, the police station only had a certain number of duty policemen.
Okay, I've got another question here. Right? Someone's asking a question. Well, I thought that Ringo, who said he wanted to be dragged off by the police. Is that right?
Just to carry on with that point I was making, the Black Maria was bringing police from other areas of London. Mm. They were bringing in reinforcements because they didn't have that huge number of staff at Savile Row police station.
I know, and all the kids in the street, they were shouting, Beatles Lives Matter, BLM. Yeah,
Ringo did say later, you know, the police were sort of bumbling around and he was disappointed that there wasn't a big scene and, you know, they weren't dragged off. That would, because, you know, they were feeding on the excitement and that would have been the logical conclusion, wouldn't it? But I you know, the police were really, really confused about what to do. They didn't want to arrest the Beatles. That would be really bad press for them. Mm-hmm. But what was really funny when I spoke to Peter Brown, for my book, he said what actually happened was that Mal Evans was talking to the police, and he sent this policeman over to me, and this guy said to me, "You have to stop this now. You know, who's your landlord?" And the police were asking about the landlords of the building, and of course, the previous year the Beatles had bought this building for £500,000. So, you know, we're the landlords. Surely we can do whatever we like. You know, so that was a real puzzle for the police.
Now, can I also say, can you imagine this scenario, right? The police are coming, right? They get upstairs and they go up where the Beatles are playing, right? And the Beatles, they figure it out, right? Apart from John. Paul's got his MBE under his everyone's got their MBE, so when they get arrested, they show their MBEs and say, if you've got a problem, go and ask the Queen.
But they only got there, what was it, about 30 minutes after it started? They weren't there at the start. It took them a while to get there and get up there. I can't remember exactly the timing, but it just occurred to me, the whole show just lasted 42 minutes. Yeah. In total with all the retakes, and that was twice as long as their previous show in Candlestick Park, 20 minutes.
Yeah, that's interesting, isn't it? Yeah.
That's right.
Which was like nearly 900 days before. I mean, they hadn't played a live gig for 885 days or something like that. It's like 2.5 years.
Yeah. Wow. And what I was going to say, how cold was it? They're doing the concert, it's cold. It's like when they're doing the movie Help and they're at Salisbury Park. In the middle of the land, it's similar to that, isn't it? They're freezing.
I was wondering about the temperature when I wrote my book. I was wondering how cold was it up there. And actually, the ambient temperature on that day wasn't that cold. It was 8 or 9 degrees centigrade, you know. Oh. But what was happening was you had I checked with the Met Office. You had a wind of 11.5 miles an hour coming from the southwest straight at their faces, which is why you see the hair blowing around, you know.
Yeah.
The wind chill would have been huge, and it takes it down to something like 2 degrees.
Right.
Well, I'll tell you what.
50 feet off the ground.
I'm sure Ringo had a few drumsticks in case he lost a couple. I can tell you that now.
Just to play drums in those kind of conditions is really hard. I mean, I've got to give him full credit because he did an incredible job. They all did. They all played great. And playing with wind and cold on the top of a roof, it's so incredible.
Amazing. Have you done that, David? Have you played a really cold gig before?
Oh, yeah, I have.
Yeah.
I like his red jacket. I got to say, was that Maureen's jacket?
Her coat, yeah.
That was Maureen's raincoat. Raincoat.
That's what I want to say. These things is after people don't know what we're talking about. Yes, Chuck, you want to ask
a debate about the coat that John was wearing, because I'm sure you might have seen a lot of pictures of John in '68, and he's wearing that coat. You can make a fuss about, you know, that's Yoko's coat that he borrowed on the day. He was always wearing that coat. There are pictures of them both in fur coats, and Yoko's usually wearing the black one, and John's usually wearing the brown one.
And, you know, guys, you know, I think David's a musician, but certainly your instruments react badly in such cold weather.
Sure. Terrible, yeah.
right? How do you keep a guitar?
I played a gig once where I just couldn't feel my fingers. I just carried on playing G major for the whole concert.
Well, by the way, talking of the John's coat, I got another email today from another good pal who was on the roof called Keith Altham, who's Tony knows. He was a young press guy. He worked for the Beatles, the Stones, and the Who, and everybody. He was on the roof. He went up there, but he had no jacket. He went up on his shirt. Yeah. He rushed there. Yeah. He was absolutely freezing. So at the end of the show, he asked John if he could borrow his coat. And John says, "You got to be kidding," or something, and just walks away. Yeah. I mean, that's kind of funny.
Let me ask you, gentlemen, is there a definitive list of who was actually on that roof?
I wish there was.
I mean, I found a few people that, that I didn't know about. If you list them, there's Ken Mansfield, who was running Apple in America, who was very kindly warmed George Harrison's fingers with his cigarettes. He lit a few cigarettes and warmed his fingers, which is good. And you know, obviously you see Yoko. There's Chris O'Dell is sitting there behind Jimmy as well. There are lots of people you don't see because they're behind cameras and they're on the other side.
Peter Brown was there, I believe.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Peter Brown.
Yeah, that's right. Peter Brown was there.
He sort of came up later, didn't he? There's a big sort of Apple sort of staff shot that they did on the roof afterwards. I think that was after the gig. But the weird thing about the concert, Tony Bramwell.
Yeah. Were you there, Tony?
There were lots of Apple people, and I haven't actually tried to identify them all. They were sort of like quite young women. I don't know who they are.
Has anybody seen an outline of the rooftop with all the people on it and the names are listed somewhere? I got a feeling that I've seen a photo of the rooftop and they list the names of the people that are there.
I've seen rough versions, but with only a few people listed. I haven't seen a definitive one, Plastic. Okay.
Someone needs to do a definitive one, David. You might be the man.
I believe Elvis was actually up there as well.
He was hidden.
And, of course, the one guy that was there who isn't really well spotted in the photos is Billy Preston. You know, he's almost invisible. On the roof, and he should be given a lot more credit as well because he was such an important part of them playing together at that time and actually doing it. I think they were kind of on their best behavior for him as well.
That was George's thinking, wasn't it? It was George Harrison's thinking. Yeah. He thought, we've got a lot of bickering here. If we bring in somebody who's a relative stranger, then we can't bicker in front of him. That would be embarrassing. So I think the Apple sessions were much more disciplined and much more peaceful than the Twickenham ones were for that reason, because Billy was there. Yeah. And Billy was, during the rehearsals, Billy was playing organ, he was playing electric piano. On the roof, he was just playing the Fender Rhodes electric piano, which is a lovely instrument.
Yes.
A lot of people make the mistake of saying he was playing organ on the roof. He wasn't. You know, no, Mojo, right. He wasn't playing organ on the roof. He was playing Rhodes electric piano, which is a beautiful instrument, actually. Have you ever played one? It's got such a great sound.
Well, it's that Get Back sound. That's the primary song for it. Yeah.
Now, listen, we spoke about the roof, the concert. I want to know what happened after the concert. Did the guys all go together to lunch or something after that? Or did they just go home? No. What happened after that?
Look on YouTube very carefully. You can find a kind of quite excited discussion about the whole thing. They're having a kind of debriefing back inside the Apple building and talking about, and, you know, why were the police talking about, you know, disturbing the peace, and they're debating that phrase and they're talking about doing a bigger and better thing another time, you know, but maybe several bands on different roofs at the same time and things like this, and having helicopters and things like this. Ooh. It was actually a Michael Lindsay Hogg idea to have a helicopter taking aerial shots, you know, as they were playing. But
now, David, I just want to stretch your memory here for a minute. Now, I believe there was a rooftop done by another band before the Beatles did Let It Be.
Just an airplane.
That's right. That's what I was going to say. And what was the time period between that?
Well, it was Michael Lindsay Hogg's idea, I believe. I mean, lots of people claim ownership of that idea to do the rooftop Beatles rooftop concert. You know, let's do the show right here, he said. And I said to Michael, did you get the idea from Jefferson Airplane? And he said, no, I didn't. He didn't know about that concert back then. He found out about it later. He was too busy working with the doing his rock and roll circus thing with the Stones and Who and everything. And he wasn't aware. And nowadays we get stuff over the internet all the time. We know what's happening in New York. We know what's happening in different cities around the world. Back then you didn't really. You know, we were like Australians.
Exactly. I'm sorry, but that's how it was. You can laugh, you can say whatever it was, but we've got the UK, we've got the US influence coming in, we've got our own culture. And we've always been behind the eight ball because of how far we are here. It's only now with the internet that we get an instant.
I did an article once for the Times about tribute bands when they were sort of kicking off in the late 90s, and I concluded that Australia was the mothership. You know, that the people like Bjorn Again and various bands, because you were so far away, you weren't on many bands itineraries, so you made your own bands, which is quite amazing, actually.
We've got our own culture and we've got our own sound here. That's true.
Yeah.
You just want to hear Australian rock, just look up Australian rock. We're nothing like anybody because we're here isolated. Like some people say, we're upside down, but we're not really upside down. The rest of the world is upside down to us. You know, a lot of people worry about dangers in Australia, you know, like come to Australia. But I got to tell you, it's nature. Here you come, crocodile can get you, spider can get you, snake can get you. But you know what it is? We don't care. They get you. We keep living. You can't believe now with the pandemic, how many Australians have gone out to buy caravans and they're all over the place now? Back the 60s when the families used to go out.
Yeah, I can believe it. Amazing. Yeah, you'd want to do that.
Let me ask, I remember
Bjorn Again, well, they were huge when they started right in the early 90s. And I actually met them at a club right when they started, met the manager, I forget his name. But, of course, before that, the bootleg Beatles had already started, and I played with them once when they were looking for a drummer.
Great.
And I knew I wasn't right, but I went along to audition for them, so I only played with them once. So this is in...
So, David, you're the bootleg Beatles Jimmy Nicol or something.
I am the Jimmy Nicol. But then I just stayed friends with them. You know, I didn't join them, but I stayed friends with Neil and Andre, who now run the band, who played John and George. And, they're still a great band. They really are.
Now, also, David, I'm just going to say something before you say something, Chachi. I say this and I mean it. If Jimmy Nicol is watching this anywhere in the world, we appeal to you to contact us because we want to interview you and all the Beatle community love you. I want you to know that. Mm. Come out, speak to everybody because you'll be embraced.
That's an incredible story.
He did a great job.
I've got three, four authors would love to write your life story. And you know what? Contact us. We'd love to have you on the show. We'd love to interview you. And a big hello to Jimmy Nicol wherever you are. Go on.
There's a great book on him. There is one great book. Have you not read it? By
Yeah, of course.
Yeah,
Jim Birkenstein.
Jim. I've already interviewed Jim. He's doing a movie. There's a movie coming out on it.
Right, that's a good subject.
On it, David. Believe me, I'm on the net 24/7. Like, anyway, Chachi, you want to say something? Please take the floor.
I want to ask both of our guests today. You know, I grew up in Cambridge, Massachusetts, right near Harvard University, and I used to go to this place called Out of Town News that had periodicals from all over the world, and I'd go there to see all the UK papers. Especially in 1970 when the breakup was happening. And I want to ask your opinion because we all know the new Get Back movie's coming out later this year. And when I first saw Let It Be in Boston in 1970, very sad film, dark, not good to see the band in this condition. But here they are now putting out a new movie with all this positive, happy footage. Why do you think they didn't use that back then? Why did they make it such a depressing and doc film about the Beatles breaking up, and now they're making this positive film.
My feeling was that Let It Be is quite representative. I mean, there were highlights, certainly, as Peter Jackson said, you know, they were playing great music. Well, at certain times they were, and a lot of that wasn't seen in the Let It Be movie. It was edited by, I can't remember the name of the guy who edited it, but I haven't heard of him since. I think it was edited very, very quickly, and a hell of a lot of footage was left out, you know. And I think that's the thing I'm really looking forward to with the Jackson film, is seeing some of the good stuff we've never seen before, you know. But I'm concerned about this revisionism of that period. You know, it wasn't a happy time. I mean, John said afterwards, it was hell having a camera poked up your nose when you're trying to play music. And George was so unhappy. As we said, he left the band at one point. So it wasn't, they weren't dancing around and having terrific fun 24/7. You know, there were highlights. Yeah. And I think that's what this new film will concentrate on. And that's a good thing, you know. But I think they should change the title to Get Happy or something.
The Partridge Family have got that. You've got to live it and get back. I think that was funny, all right?
Partridge
Family people are out there. Someone just sent a message. They should have they should play live on a bus, like the Partridge Family.
Well, David, you were about to say something about Tony's comment.
Oh yeah, no, I agree, and you know, it's obvious from looking at the trailer that Peter Jackson put out a few weeks ago. You know, the 5-minute trailer. You know, it's got incredible footage of them all doing, you know, stuff for the camera, and John and Ringo just being crazy and funny, all of them. Mm. And of course, it looks a lot more colourful because Tony, it's got that great coloured background, which I don't know if it was the original color scheme, which I used a couple of pictures in my video of a really good backing for in the studio in Twickenham, or whether that's been added in since. I've got no idea.
I'm concerned about things being added in.
I know.
So David, I just want to say something. I saw the promo. I'm not knocking it, but I actually found a lot of color coming out of their faces. You saw that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so it could be a bit of a...
I hope this hasn't gone too far and tinkered too much, because, you know, we still want the truth. You know, give me some truth.
Well, sure. Now, I believe the original version is supposed to be included in the box set, which I hope it is, so we can compare them.
Yeah. But I think you're right, you know, Charshi, the original film was maybe too bleak. You know, there should have been some happier bit moments in there. I would have liked to see Paul playing... Torchy the Battery Boy, as he did during the Twickenham rehearsals, you know, which is a favourite Gerry Anderson programme of mine. You know, Torchy Battery Boy. There was an American book that tried to figure out what he was singing at that point.
We've got Andy Candy, just so you know, right in Australia. And we got Bill and Ben Flowerpotman.
You had to put Bill and Ben. Yeah, that's good. Could you understand what Bill and Ben were saying? Because we didn't.
I'm just trying to say, in Australia, just to tell you, we were very UK. We got Bill and Ben, and we got
I was hooked on some early Australian stuff. I was hooked on the Tinker and Tucker Club when I was a kid.
Yeah, we had to suffer.
Skippy was huge. Skippy the Bush Kangaroo.
You know, we won't mention Mr. Harris because, you know, he's persona non
grata. Yeah, it's all right. Don't worry. I've got an autograph. I went to a record shop, and there, behold, is a single by Rolf Harris signed. He actually signed it to someone for $5. So I picked it up straight away.
Yeah. It's lost a lot of value now.
And also, I got to say, Tommy Kangaroo Downsport, you've heard the version of him singing with the Beatles as well, accompanying him.
Really?
Oh, yes.
Chucky, you got that one, haven't you?
Oh, yeah, I've played it on the show before.
Tell them about that one. They haven't heard of it.
I've got a book called How to Write Your Own Pop Song. And in it, he advises never use slang. So he's got this Timey Kangaroo Down Sport. And he's telling people never use slang in a song. So,
But anyway, this version of the Beatles behind him, it was like a gag. The Beatles are just stirring him while he's singing it. Because apparently, when he was on concert with them, the Beatles used to go behind the stage, behind the curtain, and sort of just play jokes with him while he's singing it. And I think he got a bit sick of it, and he made them do their jokes on a recording.
Yeah, that was at the Christmas show, 63, 64. Oh, you're right.
And you were there. I mean, you must have been there, David, as well.
Not at that one. I was at the following year at Hammersmith.
You saw another Christmas show, didn't you?
Hey, David, I'm going to say something about you. You pop up everywhere. You're the most amazing man. No invitations, no nothing. You go there, you become VIPs of
David is the Zelig.
I've got to hand it to you that you're at the right place at the right time. And even if you don't know the people, you end up knowing the right people.
I was very touched by that moment in the book where you've been drafted in to play drums in this college review, and it's late 1980, and suddenly you get the news. that John's been shot in New York.
You still
have to do this kind of like terrible like gunshot on the drums for JR.
Just to explain, that was the night of December the 9th when we had the news overnight or in the morning that John had been murdered. And I was playing drums in this medical student review, and it's in the book, but they were doing spoofs on TV shows, including Dallas, and they just screened Who Shot JR a few weeks earlier, which was the biggest story going at the time. And there was one part in the show where I had to hit my snare drum three times to indicate JR being shot. And I'm wearing a black armband. John Lennon's just been shot. And everybody in the audience, everyone froze, I think, at that moment.
Yeah,
it was just
a weird
thing to be doing that evening. It really was.
Yeah,
but
just anyway, horrible.
Got through it. But I'm just going, what was I going to say? Going back to, talking about not being invited and obviously meeting them loads of times in the 60s. But the one event I was invited to, of course, was the Let It Be premiere in May 1970. And I got the official invite from Apple. And, of course, that was the only premiere of theirs which they didn't turn up to. So, and I agree, Charchi, it was a bleak experience.
Yeah.
Out of the power, we felt pretty depressed about it. And the film, you know, the first half of it in Twickenham, extremely depressing. The Apple studio, a bit better with Billy and everybody, and it was really saved by the Rooftop show concert.
Yeah.
If it hadn't been for the Rooftop, they would never have put it out. It would have been too depressing.
Yeah, it's joyous. You see them smiling, and you know, George is doing a sort of rock star pose, kneeling down on the roof at some point, and John has got Kevin Harrington to kneel down and hold the lyrics up because he's forgotten the lyrics to Dig a Pony.
Yeah.
You know what?
It's going to be screened in the cinema because it was only supposed to be screened for one day back in October or whenever it was supposed to come out. It was only booked officially for one day, which is crazy. I want to go and see it in the cinema and hope it runs for more than one day
I just want to comment on the performance. You know, say what you want about how they were getting along, but once they were playing a song, they were playing together. You could see the joy. They smiled at each other. They loved it when they were performing a song.
Yeah,
and I don't know if you guys can comment on that at all, but certainly
the fact that they knew there was an audience and the audience was gathering around, they were aware of that. That made the difference, you know, between the rehearsals and the performance because, an audience always improves.
Especially if you've got attractive females in the audience. Being a fan, you know, it really does make a difference if you've got, you know, somebody you can make eye contact with or just see. That's, you know, and I'm sure that was the case.
We're in the 70s. Anyway, let me explain this. We're coming out of the swinging 60s. Now, gentlemen, before we wrap it up, we're near the end of the hour. I just want to say, everyone go out there and buy this fantastic book, It's All Too Much by David Stark. It's a worldwide seller. Go out and buy it. And also, I want you to go out and buy Tony Barrell's book, The Beatles on the Roof. As I said, I've seen it everywhere. Tony, I want you to tell everyone where they can buy the book.
You can get it at all reputable and irreputable bookshops. It's widely available. You know, get it from you know, your favourite bookshop. You can order it if they don't have it. You know, but
none of them are open at the moment here in the UK. I don't know about Australia.
No.
Yeah, it's a shame.
Okay, is it on Amazon, Tony?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, you can. Yeah. Yeah, you can get it on Amazon around the world.
Okay, great. Because a lot of people go to Amazon. Now, before we wrap it up, anything you want to say, Chachi?
I do. It was a pleasure to have both of you authors, you gentlemen, for being on our show today. And David is filled with so many stories, really unique, one-of-a-kind stories. And Tony, I don't know if you looked at his canon of articles that he's written, Plastic. He wrote an article on the monkeys, the girls in the UK picketing not to Davy Jones, not to go into service.
Yeah, Davy Jones, Vietnam, yeah.
And Tony, you also, I think you share a thing that I like is the occult, aliens, stories.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite books, Tony, that I have is the Chambers Dictionary of the Unexplained. I thought that you find that interesting. Yeah.
I used to be the woo-woo reporter for the Sunday Times in London, and they used to send me out to UFO gatherings and ghost hunts and things like that, and I had a whale of a time. But people don't seem to want to read that anymore. That's what they told me.
I love music now. I love that stuff.
You read a lot of that.
We gotta have Tony back because you know Plastic EP is a huge Monkees fan. We gotta talk.
Of course, I'll talk to Tony in a moment. But let me say this, guys. I want to thank you, Plastic EP Live TV, with Plastic EP and Chachi Live. We've had a big audience. This will go out to the world. Go out and buy those books. They're so great.
And the audio
book. Don't go. Until we see you next time, keep watching the show because we've got so many big guests lined up. And thank you again, David Stark. Thank you again, Tony Barrell. You guys are great. You made our evening. And as I
you're
said,
you're very welcome. Thank you so much, Plastic and Chachi, for being such great hosts.
Thank you, Tony and David, for being great guests. We really appreciate
it. It's our pleasure. And as I said, everyone go out there and play Let It Be. It's the 52nd anniversary of the rooftop concert. Watch the video. Get the Beatles things happening while you're in lockdown in the UK and while you're in the US. Keep playing. Hey, Chachi, I need that book. Okay. See ya.
Cheers.
Thanks a lot.